Hey everyone, welcome to this week's Azure Infrastructure Update. It's the 31st of March, so the end of Q1, and a few updates this week. As always, I have the chapters, so you can jump to a particular update that you may care about the most. New videos this week, I create a video about the spot mix capability of virtual machine scale set flexible mode orchestration. This lets me say I want a certain percentage of VMs it creates from the profile to be regular, pay as you go, and the other part percentage being spot. I get that cheaper for what is that spare capacity. So I went in how exactly that works. Then a really quick video on what's waking up my PC. I put it to sleep, I come back in, it's wide awake. Why is that? Now, before I go any further, just a really quick story, and you can skip this really easily, but don't be like John. If you're troubleshooting something, make sure you keep an open mind, and specifically, don't impose constraints, restrictions, requirements that don't actually exist. Don't just assume maybe what was there in the past still exists today, because you may have noticed last week the lighting was very, very bright. I changed the camera in here a few weeks ago just to a face cam pro, just to make my life easier. Instead of being a regular camera, going to a capture card, it's much easier for me to use. But the lighting was all messed up and I was having to mess around with shutter settings and ISO settings and color temperature. I could not get it right. It was always too bright. It just didn't work. And the solution, as it turned out, was to lower the lights in the room. I'd imposed on myself, oh, the lights are at 100% because I needed it for the old camera. Anything I change has to be the camera. Nope, I just lowered the lights to 50% and yet fixed the problem. So my point is, when you're troubleshooting, make sure you are really clear on what are the real requirements, what are the real constraints. Don't artificially impose some restriction on how you solve the problem, because then you'd be like John and waste 2 weeks. Anyway, on to what's actually new. So on the compute side, if I'm using Azure Site Recovery, the ability to replicate VMs, well now for that replicated VM, when it gets created, I have the option of changing the disks and or the network interface names. By default, it would just be the same as the source, but I can now, as part of that protection configuration, say, hey, actually, if it fails over, I want it to have a different name. Then for Azure Migrate, we now have support for ASP.NET and Java applications running on IIS and Tomcat. So what this is going to do today is it's all about discovery and assessment. So it will be able to discover those applications, regardless if it's bare metal, a Hyper-V VM, a VMware virtual machine, and it will be able to assess its suitability for migration to Azure App Service, what SKU it should use, what plan it should use, and any considerations, and then even show you what the estimated cost would be. So it's not going to then migrate all of those today, but in terms of my assessment and getting ready, it's going to give me all of that information in preview. And then for AKS, so the Azure Kubernetes Service, we now have the Azure AD workload identity generally available. This is a replacement for the old pod identity, where I could have a certain managed identity made available to pods so they could then use to authenticate to other Azure resources. The problem is that solution was fairly heavy and it had extra pods you had to have laying around. It was fairly cumbersome. Well, this new solution uses functionality of Kubernetes. It will work for any Kubernetes offering. It's obviously AKS, but it could be in other clouds, it could be running on premises, whatever that is. And it's gonna work for Windows and Linux workloads. So what it's actually gonna do, it removes those custom pods we had to have before, and instead it's gonna now use the native Kubernetes OIDC, OpenID Connect Federation capability. So what will now happen is Kubernetes has these account tokens that it can project into a pod. And then once the pod gets that Kubernetes identity, that service account, I have that Kubernetes issue token, then through the OpenID Connect federation endpoints of some other identity provider. For example, Azure AD has this endpoint. I'll take my Kubernetes given token and say, hey, Azure AD, can I exchange this, please? I would have set up that federation in Azure AD with my Kubernetes. So now I can give it a Kubernetes issued token, and then Azure AD will give me an Azure AD generated token that I can then present to other services. So it's a lot more powerful and I'm not doing special things. This is more of a standard driven thing. So this is now generally available. So if my pods need a Azure AD generated token to talk to other services, I can now have managed identities and make it available to specific pods. So I'm going to project that Kubernetes token into specific pods that I pick. And then AKS Kubernetes version 1.26 is now supported in preview, so I can start playing around with that. And for Azure Container apps, we now have the ability to mount both Azure Files and ephemeral storage generally available. So Azure Files will be durable. That's in our storage account, it's NFS, for example, mounted, and it's available to multiple pods, so I can have read and write access, I can share the data, and it's durable because it's in a storage account. The ephemeral storage, well, that's the storage that's on a specific node. So with Azure Container apps, remember that abstracts away the Kubernetes but gives me Dapper and Keda and sidecars and great networking capabilities. Well, if I think about, I have replicas, which is a scale unit in Azure Container apps, think of it as a particular node, well, that has that local storage. So pods running on that particular replica are running on the same node, so have access to the same local storage. So they could mount that ephemeral storage and share between them when they're part of that same replica. On the networking side, we now have IP protection SKUs for distributed denial of service protection. So in the past, to get the standard distributed denial of service protection, we had to enable it at the virtual network level. And it would then protect all of the public IPs associated with that virtual network. That gave me great monitoring. It gave me app-specific tuning for the recognition of some kind of attack. I had mitigations, I had metrics, I had alerts or reporting, but it was the entire virtual network and I had to buy it in this pretty big plan. What this lets me do is buy it for individual public IP addresses. Now I get all of the same protection capabilities. I do not get rapid response support. I do not get cost protection. I don't get web application firewall discounts, but all of the actual tuning to my individual application, the monitoring, the metrics, I get all of that. So now I can do it at an individual public IP level. On the storage side, so Azure Files NFS, remember Azure Files traditionally supported SMB, but when I have Azure Files Premium, I also get the NFS options. Well, now it supports nconnect. This is now generally available. So nconnect is the ability for the client side mount option. And essentially it's going to use multiple TCP connections so I get a larger aggregate IOPS and throughput. So yes, it is going to consume more connections, but now that connection will have a higher IOPS, a higher throughput. And if you think about just the massive scale that's available with Azure Files Premium, it's pretty hard to max that out. I'd have to have lots and lots of clients connecting. Well, now with this capability, I can have a fewer number of clients and actually save myself money because each client can do more IOPS, more throughput, and take better advantage of all of that throughput and IOPS available as part of Azure Files Premium. Premium SSD V2 is now available in new regions. This is now East US 2, North Europe, and West US 2. I did a whole video on Premium SSD V2, but basically the big shift from V1 to V2 is V2 acts more like UltraDisk. Yes, I have a capacity, but then the IOPS and the throughput are individual dials that I can even change dynamically. So I only have the IOPS and the throughput I need at any particular given moment in time. So, hey, I can use that in more regions. And then Defender for Storage now has malware scanning agentless. So if I think about the blobs I have in Azure Storage, well, Defender for Storage is now actually gonna give me scanning for both metamorphic and polymorphic malware. This means they change, like they try and hide themselves. Polymorphic changes its shape by modifying its encryption key so the payload looks different. the metamorphic actually rewrites its code every time, so it's harder to detect. But both of those will be detected by this Defender for Storage. It's analyzed in near real time, and then it will actually store the results. And I could then actually have alerts triggering with those details. And of course, once an alert triggers, I could write my own automations to do other types of remediation. So I can do a lot of great stuff with that Defender for Storage. It can also look for sensitive data, which would help me detect, for example, exfiltration. Hey, someone's taking my data and copying it somewhere else. I would be able to find that. On the database side, so Event Hub now has resource governance. This is all about, for the premium and dedicated tiers, well, I can group client applications, so the applications that are connecting to the Event Hub for both publish and consumption purposes, into these application groups. I might create an application group, for example, of lower priority clients, because on these application groups, I can then apply throttling. I could apply throttling in terms of how many bytes, how many messages. So this would say, well, now maybe these lower priority app groups are throttled to this certain level so they don't interfere with the more important applications and potentially impact their performance. So I now have that resource governance. Cosmos DB for MongoDB now has a vCore option. We're used to the idea of request units, but now this is an alternate option. Request unit is great for those cloud native type applications. This vCore will be more useful for lift and shift. Hey, I'm currently using MongoDB. I want to take it, stick it in the cloud, but I still want it managed. Well, this vCore option will be more familiar, will be a better fit and just work. It's still managed, but now I pay based on number of CPUs, the amount of memory, the number of nodes, and the amount of storage. I can scale out, so more instances, I can scale up. And one of the nice things is, I don't have to start worrying about sharding keys until I get into terabytes worth of data. So it really is, hey, this should just work, and I can just start using it. And then Azure SQL Database audit to a storage account can now use a user-managed identity. So if I set up auditing in SQL Database, well, it has to have permissions to be able to write into the storage account. And traditionally, I could use a shared access signature, or I could use a system-assigned managed identity, i.e. its lifecycle of the managed identity is tied directly to that SQL DB. What this lets me do is I can now, for the SQL DB, add a user-assigned managed identity, which has its own lifecycle, could be used by multiple resources. I make that the primary identity for that SQL DB instance. And then when I turn on the auditing, it would use that managed identity to get access to the storage account. Miscellaneous. So Chaos Studio, creating those experiments to say, hey, if a zone is down, if a rack is down, if the CPU is doing this, whatever those might be, is now available in Brazil South in preview. And then Azure Site Recovery, well, it uses automation accounts for some of its recovery processes as part of its site recovery infrastructure. Well, in the past, it had these run as accounts. They've really been phased out, and instead we should be using managed identities. Well, now there's a really nice migration capability. I can go in and say, hey, I want to migrate to managed identity, and it would change those automation accounts being used from a run as to using managed identity. I mentioned this one before. So Azure Monitor now has audit logging policies, both initiatives, which are sets of policies and individual policies in GA. This is really based around the idea that, well, I want to make sure on my resources, they have the correct diagnostic settings configured to send the data I want to some sync, be it Event Hub or Log Analytics Workspace or Storage Account or third party integrated solution. So with these policies, I can make sure that they are rolled out. They do have those settings done correctly. And then also, Azure Monitor now has duplicate alert rules. So if I have an alert rule, what this lets me do is just say, hey, I want to copy it. And really that just has the net effect. If I'm looking at my alert rules here, if I select, for example, a rule, we just see this option of duplicate. And when I run that, it will then trigger the wizard, but it will pre-populate it with all of the conditions from the alert rule I'd already configured. So this would be useful if, for example, I had some alert wall configured that was pretty close to a new one I wanted to create, but I wanted to tweak a few things rather than start again. Hey, I'll just copy the old one. And then finally, Azure Image Builder now lets you create the configurations directly in the portal. So I can just go to, for example, hey, I want to create a new image template, and it will be able to walk me through, hey, what customizations I want. I can do Windows and Linux. It's all based on the HashiCorp Packer technology. So I could take a marketplace image of an OS. I could have my own in the shared image gallery. Well, now it's called the Azure Compute Gallery. Apply customizations to create new images that I could then use for my virtual machine scale sets, my VM creations, my Azure virtual desktop environments, but it lets me walk through and, hey, define those images I want to get built. And that was it. As always, I hope this was useful. Until next video, take care.